The Gravel Institute is a nonprofit founded to continue the life of Senator Mike Gravel, a great American who doesn't get enough credit for exposing the Pentagon Papers. He read the Pentagon Papers into the congressional record. Very few people know that. Mike Gravel advocated for direct democracy in order to achieve a just and equal society. Go to gravelinstitute.org and learn about its mission to build the institutions the left needs to win. Joining us is Henry Williams, who I believe you are the director of the Gravel Institute. Henry?
Hello, what yes. Co-founder of the Institute, and currently I serve, we have three directors, but I work on press relations and strategy and fundraising.
Well, thank you for coming on here. Mike Gravel, who we lost, I believe, last June, was dragged kicking and screaming, running for president. You forced him to run for president. In 2007, he threw a rock into a lake, and late night comedians made fun of him. He is a true American hero. You changed your website. He posted his platform for president. Where is it on the website?
Oh, we still have it. So this is from the presidential campaign website, which is no longer up. But if you search it, it's still public. I have a link to it, which I can find and send to you.
Okay.
Take a look for it.
That is,
it's still out there.
It's the Bible. He was on the Ralph Nader Radio Hour a year or two ago, and I started reading his platform, and I thought, well, here you go. This is the pathway to perfection. How did you get involved with the Gravel Institute?
Absolutely. Well, first of all, real quick, I would love to hear what you think. What are some of the things in the platform that you are interested in? But I'll introduce the Gravel Institute first, because I would love to get into it. And I actually just found it, and I will share with you right now. But the Gravel Institute was an outgrowth of the campaign in 2020. And the story of the campaign is obviously a bizarre one. It was that Mike was retired. He was living at his house in Seaside, California. And some friends and I contacted him from his website and started asking him if he wanted to run for president again after he had in 2008. And at first he's like, this is a crazy idea. I don't want to be president, first of all. I can't win, second of all. And we said, that's not a problem with us at all. The reason that we wanted him to run was for the same reason he ran in 2008, which is he was able to stake out a position that no other candidate was willing to take. I mean, he stood up there on stage with the leading figures of the Democratic Party in the decades since then, you know, Barack Obama, Joe Biden, and Hillary Clinton. And he took them to task over the Iraq War, which all of them were incredibly squishy on and unwilling to say the things that most Americans even believed about it. And those clip, I mean, the clip, you know, from that debate is immortal, I think. And you can say it's been viewed millions of times since he first did it. He was a gadfly and an outsider candidate, and yet something about what he said and how he said it and who he said it to made an impression, even in the minds of people like me who were 9 years old when it happened. And so when we discovered that and found him, we started talking to him. And in those conversations, we basically told him, you know, where you were, we are now. There is a left now. You know, there's something now. And young people are thinking the way that you were talking then. In 2008, he was the first candidate to ever march in a gay pride parade. In the 1970s, he was the only person in Congress to favor gay marriage. He was endorsed by the National Harvey Milk Club every time he ever ran. They even gave him an award, basically, as one of the only national politicians speaking out for gay rights in the 1960s and 70s. So Mike was somebody who was out ahead of the curve his entire life. And what we wanted to tell him was, you know, the world has caught up to you to some extent, maybe not the world, young people, the left, whatever has caught up with you. And if you tried to run, I think people would respond to it. And that's what happened. And so the Gravel Institute came out of that. He told us, if we do this campaign, I want you to commit that you're going to go somewhere with it. It's not just going to be a flash in the pan, you know, that there's going to be some end goal. And after the campaign, we thought, what can we do with the social media following? What can we do with the people who are interested? And the goal was to make educational YouTube videos online explaining the core tenets of the left, politics, history, economics, and giving people the education that they're not going to get otherwise, and certainly not the education that PragerU and the right wants them to get.
So he was from Alaska. He was a congressman from Alaska. He spent most of his life in Democratic politics, right? He was like Speaker of the House in Alaska. Most of his adult life was in politics, right?
Yeah, so he actually, when he graduated college, he wanted to go into politics. He was very against the Vietnam War and he was very politically engaged, but there was really no path for him. He was from Massachusetts and there were too many Kennedys there. That's what he said to me. And right. So he said, there's two new states coming out, New Mexico and Alaska. And New Mexico had just been founded, but Alaska was the new one. He said, well, I'll just flip a coin. And he flipped a coin. He decided on Alaska. He went there, no job, started as a railway brakeman. 10 years later, as the Speaker of the Alaska House. And then he was its second ever senator.
Right. So you would ask me, what is it about Mike Gravel that I liked in his platform? And if you're going to send, I don't have it in front of me. It's been a year since I read it. I think it was like a Google Doc.
Yeah, I actually just sent a link in the chat if you want to. If you're able
yeah.
to.
Yeah. Is there a way for you to put it up on the website? What I remember being struck by was you cannot separate what we do overseas from what we do to ourselves here in America. That how we treat Iraq, Afghanistan, Saudi Arabia, Israel, South Korea, how we sell, the way we sell arms and remain in a military footing, you cannot separate from how we treat our own. It should not surprise us that 1,000 Americans, more than 1,000 Americans, were killed in 2021 by the police, that we've militarized the police. You cannot separate a war economy from underfunded schools and the high suicide rate in this country. It's all connected. And so that's what struck me. And then ways to reform our voting. And obviously he was an environmentalist who did not think too kindly of corporations. And he goes all the way back to the Pentagon Papers. This is the guy who got his hands on the Pentagon Papers. I think he read it into the congressional record before the Washington Post and the New York Times published it. Is that correct?
Yeah, that is correct. And actually, so basically, the reason he was written out of the story is because
Tom Hanks,
the Washington Post. Yeah, exactly. The Washington Post and the New York Times, that was their hero moment and they wanted to seize it. But the reality was they only started publishing it after he had set a legal precedent, which is that it was in the public domain. Because senators can say anything they want on the House floor, on the Senate floor, they cannot be punished for it. And so if you read something that's classified, it becomes unclassified by reading it. His act of doing that, for which he almost went to jail, it was a Supreme Court case, United States v. Gravel. And he was pretty worried about it at the time.
And yet we don't even make a hero out of him. We make a hero out of Katharine Graham from the Washington Post. And and Daniel Ellsberg from the Brookings Institute.
Right. And really, they were actually bit players in the quite legal question, because, again, they were not the risk takers. He was the one who took the risk and they came along behind and took a lot of the credit. And to what you said before about connecting the war abroad to the war at home, it was first in his mind in that era, because it was the Riverside speech from Dr. King that was, of course, some people believe precipitated his death, and was the act where he connected the Vietnam War to the racial and economic struggle at home. And after his death, one of the aspects of
the Riverside Church.
On the Upper West Side, Dr. Martin Luther King Jr., he went to the Riverside Church about 3 weeks before he died, and he gave a famous speech where he tied the war in Vietnam to the war on poverty and the war on racial inequality in America. And he said, we cannot fight that struggle here while fighting this one abroad. And it was first in the mind of a lot of the left of that era. And another aspect of Dr. King's legacy that is totally written out is that he was in favor of a jobs guarantee. That was actually what the March on Washington was originally connected to. And his widow, Coretta Scott King, did a ton of tremendous work on looking at how America paid for Vietnam and how it paid for the Cold War, and asking, why can we not use these same tactics, these same techniques, to pay for a jobs guarantee and a war on poverty at home. And the reality mm-hmm. is basically you can't do both, right? You have to choose. And the choice that we made was imperialism abroad and not social policy at home.
Right. By the way, the Reverend Barry W. Lynn, who does our 8 o'clock hour every week, was at that speech at the Riverside Church. So we'll talk about that later with him. You're wearing a Patagonia sweatshirt.
I was wearing it because I was laundry.
Patagonia is a good company. Isn't Patagonia a good company?
One of the better ones, but I'm a little wary of it signing them any and giving them too many brownie points. But this is my laundry day shirt.
I had the founder, he passed away, the founder of Patagonia. People should look up Patagonia. I don't endorse any companies, but the founder of Patagonia, he was on my show. He was a good steward, if such a thing is possible, of capitalism. Is there a way to do capitalism right?
Well, this is, I mean, gigantic.
Does the left, the left, you're out front saying you're a leftist. Did Gravel identify as a leftist throughout most of his career?
He did. I mean, he had a complicated relationship to it, but he started on the anti-war left and the anti-poverty left. And he went through a long journey of, I mean, you have to say he became disillusioned with both parties very deeply. And after he left office, he was essentially in the wilderness as a gadfly. And as a gadfly, he was focused on the things he cared about, nuclear disarmament and on America's foreign policy and ending it and changing it. And for those, he focused on the people who were his allies, which happened to be libertarians, which, I mean, basically anyone at that era. And there was very, very few people who were speaking out. But, you know, once politics had rearranged a couple more times, by the time we got to today, he very much identified with the political left. And certainly in 2020, I mean, you know, I challenge people to go take a look at that platform, because that was us sitting down in a room with him and hammering out, what do we really believe in? And it came down to these core planks. So that was fundamental political reform, transforming American foreign policy.
Do you mind if I ask you a personal question?
Yeah, absolutely.
Are you 19 years old?
I'm 21.
Help me. So as I understand it, you and your friend were listening to the Chapo Trap House, correct?
This is how we first heard of him, yeah.
You were listening to a podcast, a left-wing podcast. They mentioned Mike Gravel. And then you and your friend, you were, what, seniors in high school? What year is this?
I was in college. My friend was a senior in high school. And yeah, we heard about him there first originally. And actually, I had right at the time been reading a history of the Pentagon Papers and the Vietnam War. And the two kind of threads connected. And we were like, holy crap. And then we saw the 2008 debate clips. Was who we came to, and we became obsessed with this guy, researched him a bunch, found his personal website, and we emailed him. I mean, we assumed no way that he would reply to us. He replied to us within about 10 minutes after we sent the email, because he was just hanging out. And I don't know, you know, it was a back and forth about 3-4 weeks. We spoke with him on the phone, just telling him what we believed, what he believed, and trying to convince him that we could accomplish something with it. And then, yeah, he eventually agreed to it.
Amazing. Do you mind if I ask you, what, I'm curious, you're 21. Mm. Your definition of being on the left, how do you define it?
Well, I think since the emergence of, you know, industrial society, I mean, since the emergence of capitalism, as we call it, throw the word around, I mean, what does it mean? What do we mean when we say it about 2021, 2022? That's a complicated question. But there's a tradition which has said that the collective human agency, basically us serving our own interests, our own ends, versus artificial ones that we create and imagine and project, like money and commodities and production and ownership. These are ultimately fictions, myths that we invent, and then they come to have a fake reality and existence outside of us, and then they dominate us. Those concepts which we
in order to justify that, in order to justify them, you have to create more fictions,
exactly,
and more myth. Hence, right, the New York Times, the Washington Post, and Rachel Maddow.
Exactly. And you build an entire society around taking a set of myths and pretending that they're realities. And when you naturalize them, you forget that they're made by humans and they can be unmade by humans. And in some deep sense, the people who have been saying that since the beginning have been the intellectual tradition of the left. And what that is today, what that means today, is certainly not the industrial proletariat, because it's not a thing that exists in the way that it once did at another era of history. And so what we even mean when we say these things is a little bit more open-ended. But the underlying tendency, which is to say humans can choose their own destiny collectively, and we should do so and not let some dominate and others suffer by virtue of myths, either whatever, whether those myths are feudalism and religion or whether those myths are commodities and exchange. They're all just different mythologies that we use to take human power and human choices and pretend that they're the acts of nature or of God and out of our control. And to me,
what do you
the
think?
People who've been what saying that, that's what I identify with. That's where I come from politically.
Yeah. In terms of marketing, which is a bad word, what are the lies that are repeated constantly that the left has to counter with marketable, almost aphorisms, truths? You know, the right says supply side economics. You lower taxes for the wealthy, it boosts, it stimulates the economy. And that's received wisdom. That's a lie. The right says the Taliban, the Afghanistan people attacked us on 9/11. It's a lie. If you can't even say that, you can't even call that a lie. It's a disservice to the troops.
Right.
Keynesian economics creates inflation, that a safety net will destroy the value of the dollar. And we just accept this as received wisdom. What are the truths that we need to repeat over and over again? What are the basic truths that—
Right. Well, here's what I say. I mean, you're an American, you love freedom. Let's say that's what you imagine it. Okay. So break down the hours in your day for me. Okay. 8 hours sleeping, 8 hours, I don't know, doing whatever, eating, cooking, all the things you have to do to maintain your life with your kids, raising your family, et cetera. And what do you spend the other 8 hours doing? What do you spend actually the majority of your productive adult working hours in your entire lifetime? 80 to 100,000 hours or more of your entire life doing. And where are you doing that? You're doing that at a workplace. And let me ask, how free are you there? Because when you're at work, your boss is your dictator. They're your lord. They have total control over what you do. The people who own the industries that you work in, they control it. And maybe there's some regulations and OSHA that'll step in and make it a little less bad for you. Maybe. And in all likelihood, probably not. Let's ask another question. I mean, about theft. Maybe you really care about crime and about theft. Well, the majority of all theft in the entire country every year is employers stealing from employees. You know, on the other hand, we talk about our legal system and how it's great for individuals or how it's so free, whatever. At the same time, let's say I take $200 out of my boss's cash register on the job. They can call the cops and send me to prison. If I resist, they can shoot me while they're doing that. Okay, let's say my boss forces me to work a couple extra hours and doesn't pay me or takes $200 out of my paycheck. And I want to do something about that. I can call the cops. And the cops will say, fuck off. We don't control that here. We don't do that here. So what do you have to do? You have to call up the Civil Rights Bureau. You have to tell them about a wage theft complaint. You got to get a lawyer. You got to submit it. If it's under $2,000, they're not even going to touch it. They won't even start. If it's over $2,000 or you got a bunch of people together, or maybe you just complain for a really long time, they'll start the process. That's going to take about 10 months beginning to end. Okay. Maybe at the end of that process, they get a $1,000 fine. That's it. But if you steal from your boss, you're going to go to jail and it's going to transform your entire life. Our legal system, the basic structures of our government and society are designed to privilege people who own and control and disadvantage ones who don't. And again, the people who own, why do they own? They inherited it. They got it from there. Or, oh, they earned it through education. But how did they get into that elite education in the first place? How did they get all these things? When you start breaking all these things down, you have to say, how different is what we have from feudalism? How different is it from a social system where I control and I own and you don't? But again, I mean, people will then say, oh, you're doing class warfare, you're doing this or that. At the same time, what I'll also say is we have an interest in society itself succeeding and flourishing. And so long as we are crushing our most talented, so long as we're underutilizing people, can't get an education, whatever, we as a whole are also worse off. I mean, it's not just me versus you, whatever, we all collectively are worse off. I got another one, which I always bring up. You know, you love your car and your house and everything, but you don't love your commute. You don't love all your other cars. The reality is you like your car, but you don't like cars. You don't like other people's cars. You don't like roads. You know, cars, they're like villas on the sea, right? It's fun if you have one, but if everyone has them, there's no room, right? There's no space. And this is the fundamental problem. We built our entire society around a geometry problem, which is you have one person for one giant metal box and you want to build a city, you suddenly can't because you need a place to store all those giant metal boxes. And so you don't have cities. You have these giant spread out suburban agglomerations where you're alienated, separated from people. You don't have a community. You don't have a neighborhood. You don't have the kind of social bonds that kept that for which people of the past lived for, you know? Anyway, these are the things that I'm always throwing out there, because I think if you actually take people's stated values, freedom, independence, autonomy, all these things, you don't get any of that today. That's not the deal you're getting.
God, you make me feel great. I'm Thank so you. Tired of being tired. I'm tired of people who are tired, who aren't angry, who aren't. Will you come back? I want to promote the Institute, and our professor Harvey J.K. is going to be here later. I believe he gave a talk.
Absolutely love Harvey. He came and did a video with us on FDR's most important, most forgotten speech, where he said we need a second Bill of Rights. And again, another classic story, which you should ask Harvey about and get him to talk about, is that originally FDR's vice president, what's his name, Henry Wallace, who was a crusading social reformer, land reformer, proto-socialist type, he almost became president because he was his vice president. And when he was running for re-election in 1942, I'm forgetting which one, but when he ran for re-election, they made him take him off and put on Truman, the party bosses, because they realized FDR was in bad health and they were very afraid of Henry Wallace becoming president. And if he had, we would be living in a very different kind of country. Harvey's a great person to ask about that.
Yeah, well, you're a great person to ask about this. Do you find people saying to you, because they say it to me, you're a child, but I'll say something like, instead of bombing Syria, why don't we just drop bombs and books and medicine? And people say to me, well, you're a child for thinking that way. And I can't figure out why that's childish. Or do people call you naive? What are some of the condescending pushback?
Right. I get it all the time. And listen, I also have a privileged background, and people will talk about that and they'll say, well, listen, I mean, hypocrite, right? Hypocritical from the beginning. And listen, an aspect of this is true, because I'm able to say this stuff because I started reading a bunch of books and I started getting into it. And now I believe what I believe. And people will say, well, you don't really know the world. You haven't experienced it. You haven't seen it. So I take what I believe and I throw it up against the world. I mean, I go to bars and I ask people, you know, coming back from days where I'll ask them, how do you feel about your job? And I'll show our videos to just random people I meet just to hear what they say about them and what they think about them. To me, the thing about adults in the room, the thing about people who are serious, is that when they come in contact with what actual Americans believe, what the actual average person believes, I mean, to be fair, I mean, this is one reason why people like Joe Rogan are so hated. And not that I have particular love for him, but it's because they represent the kind of basic both incoherence, but also populism of average people, which is that they have a sense that they're being screwed. They have a sense of deep distrust. You know, the adults in the room, what they'll tell you is, well, you're not an adult. You're not serious because your ideas don't align with the powerful. You know, the powerful say, Syria, we have to bomb. The powerful say, we need this security perimeter in Ukraine. You know, the powerful say, this is how economics works. And this is how society works and how law works. But the powerful have created the last 20 years of American carnage that we've all lived through. I mean, they precipitated 2008. And guess what? They're still there. And they're still the adults. They're still the serious people. But how much trust does the average person still have for serious people, for authority figures? I mean, it is shattered. If you look 30, 40 years ago, there's these polls where they'll ask, do you have basic trust in American institutions or the media, the mainstream media? And it used to be 80, 90%. And today it's like 20, 30%. I mean, there's been a utter collapse in trust in those serious people. And it's because they were utterly wrong and they created 20 years of suffering for the rest of us. And so I take being unserious, being outside the club, that's a compliment to me, because ultimately the people in the club have been fucking it up for pretty long now.
What I love about Mike Gravel and what I loved about your campaign, because it was the platform, because it's not a critique of America. It's, this is how we fix it. My complaint about the Democratic Party and liberals is the most you can get for them is they'll acknowledge the problem, but they're not willing to offer up the solutions. I'm going to bring in Professor Ben Burgess. I think you're going to do, have you been on a show yet?
I haven't, but I love Professor Burgess, and I think we've spoken before, although I'm not sure when.
I'm going to bring him in. You should be on his show. So what are, speaking to Mike Gravel's platform, what are the issues that will fix? What are the bills in Congress? What are the solutions?
Well, there's one that comes ahead of everything else and precipitates everything else. What you just said, which is that Democrats will agree with the problem, but aren't willing to go through with the solution. And that's because one of those solutions is totally upending our constitutional order, because the Senate and the Electoral College and the way that districts are apportioned, and even the way that states have this inordinate power, all of it makes no sense. I mean, all of it is grounded in the political economy of a slave-holding, colonial, agrarian society that is utterly unlike the one we have today. And those political structures remain a permanent and fundamental barrier to that ultimate progress. I mean, people talk about the rotating villain, you know, the one person they always blame to say, oh, we can't have healthcare because Joe Manchin or this or that. But the structure that allows them to do that in the first place is the Senate, the filibuster, the Electoral College. We have to start there. I mean, if those things don't change, nothing else is truly possible. And even if you were to...
Let me push back on that, and then I want to bring Professor Ben Burgess in here. You're right. I just don't see us getting rid of the Senate.
Well, this is why it's a stretch goal for me. You know, it's as you negotiate down, I guess.
I know, but like the planet has 10 years left.
Right.
And we need... we need leadership. We need a candidate who's going to storm the Democratic Party, I believe. And it's really up to you. I'm old, but I think we need to storm the Democratic Party, take it over, do a purge, and have three issues that are non-negotiable, where if you're not for Medicare for all, if you're not for the Green New Deal, get out of the party. But what do you think right now? I understand. I agree with you that the Senate is a leftover, as is the filibuster from the Jim Crow South, right, from slavery.
We actually do? You know, what can actually,
yeah, like overturning Citizens United? I don't believe we should invest our energy into overturning Citizens United. I believe that our candidates should just not take corporate dollars, period. Right. So what can we do right now that...
Right. Well, I agree with the premise, which is you surge into the party with a candidate that comes from outside of what people imagine to be the political establishment and the political structures, that comes in with issues and with a platform that's unheard of and breaks every boundary and rule. I think that's where you start. I think if you have that moment, you need to use it to do structural reform of one kind or another, however far you can go. I mean, if it's the filibuster, it's the filibuster. If it's the Electoral College, it's the Electoral College. The Electoral College, by the way, with the state level compact, is actually possibly quite close to being overturned. Yeah. So there's some optimistic things there.
Yeah, you're right. It's two states. You really are a gift. And give the... email address. How can people support you, and how can they support the Gravel Institute other than going to gravelinstitute.org?
Absolutely. First thing I would just say, you can go to youtube.com, type in the Gravel Institute. It's spelled Gravel, G-R-A-V-E-L, the Gravel Institute, but it's pronounced Gravel. Go watch some of the videos, subscribe, see if you like them. If you really like us and you really want to support us, you can go to patreon.com/Gravel Institute and support the work of the Institute. We don't get any other donations. We're completely crowdfunded. That's how we make the videos to begin with. If you really, really like it and want to go further, you can reach me at henry@gravelinstitute.org. If you have an idea for a video, someone we should work with, a presenter we should have, that sort of thing. Professor Burgess, we'd probably love to have you in a video at some point. So any of those kinds of things, you can reach out to me directly. But otherwise, I would just say check us out on YouTube and see what you think of the videos. And if you have thoughts, you can also email them to me and I'd love to see them.
Thank you for taking time to be with us. Go to the Gravel Institute. Go to their website, gravelinstitute.org. Read some of their papers, like The Leisure Agenda. It's a policy paper outlining how overworked we all are. And there's some great writing over there. And Professor Harvey J.K. You can see.
Of course, I would tell him hello for me. Say we love him, and we'll have him back for a video in the future too.
Thank you for taking time to do this. Very good. Bye-bye. Thank you so much.